Good evening, happy Easter, and welcome to Inside Story. I am Moeth Games. Inside Story is a weekly magazine program produced by the Agency for Public Information. It highlights government's plans, projects, and policies at work in your communities. Inside this edition, the Ministry of Transport and Works upgrades feeder roads around the country. Eclair Valley youth Simisha Batiste is putting cornfish on the front burner. We bring you part two of the quadrille feature. The cross is the way to go. Learn how to make palm crosses on Community Beat. On Inside Minute, we take you back to the roots of Easter. And Reverend Adolph Davis brings a message of hope and comfort. Stay with us, an interesting package lies ahead. Inside Story continues after the break.
As we battle the unseen enemy, COVID-19, remember to be kind to each other, be a good neighbor, help someone less fortunate than yourself, be your brother's keeper. Together, we can overcome COVID-19. A message by the National Reconciliation Advisory Committee.
You're viewing Inside Story. Welcome back. Over $30 million EC dollars have been allocated to road repairs and upgrades under the National Agricultural and Feeder Roads Project. The project, already underway, will see 10 roads completed by Kuwait Dynamic Limited, KDL. Project engineer Quincy James led the tour of works in Connery, Montreal, Sears, Brighton, and Blair on Thursday, March 25, 2021. Here's more from Keisha Woodley.
The transformative power of a road cannot be overstated. Proper road access means social and economic development, access to employment, health, and education services. In St. Vincent and the Grenadines, one of the plights of farmers is traversing unpaved and rugged terrains to get to and from their farms. In many instances, these agricultural and feeder roads limit vehicular access so that the work of the farmer is twice as cumbersome to get supplies in and their crops out. In light of this, the Ministry of Transport and Works is working assiduously to complete as many agricultural and feeder roads to facilitate ease of access, not only for farmers, but for those who call these areas their home. Project engineer at the Ministry of Transport and Works, Quincy James, led the tour of several agricultural and feeder road projects on Thursday, 25th March, 2021.
This is phase one of the National Agricultural and Feeder Road Project, which consists of 10 roads, right? So this is the Connery Road. It's around 0.95 kilometers in length, consists of a pavement, concrete pavement width of about 4 meters with box drain, curb and slippers and curbs, right? It's more or less predominantly giving access to farmers within this area here. The government, seeked a financial loan to get funding for these 10 roads from CAFED. That's the Kuwait Fund for Arabic Economic Development. The total amount for these 10 roads, it's around $32 million EC dollars. So this is dispersed between those 10 roads, ranging from Belay at Arnosville up to Connery up here, right? We have a few roads in the central area of St. Vincent, which is Mesopotamia. And we have like a few other roads along the eastern coast, like Brighton and so forth, right? So that $32 million would be spent on these 10 roads.
The project is coordinated by Brook Hale, while NACO, a Kuwaiti firm, and DIWI, a British Caribbean firm, are the project's consultants. The contractor is Kuwait Dynamic Limited, KDL.
So this is the phase one of this project. We are in Connery Road. So this road is almost at 80% of curb and slipper, and the pavement, as you see, is concrete road. So we are expect to finish this road according to the schedule.
What's the schedule?
The schedule is to finish in October. Yeah, we are a contractor. I'm the engineer of that company. We have all the project to do. all the pavement, all the sleeper drain, all the culvert and everything. We are the contractor for all the activities in this road.
We have here the foreman on this project, Leroy Pope. He's a Connery man and he can give us a better idea of what this road was like before the construction project started.
Yeah, this road, it was a hill and gully. The farmers used to get problems now to pay people to take their material, their produce from right over here and over there to bring them here to where the vehicle could reach them. Well, now since this road was graded by the KDL operators, them, they done a good work. So right now, everybody happy. Everybody smiling again because vehicle come in here to buy coconut, buy planting, tanya. So no problem for right now.
What's your schedule deadline?
All construction should be completed on the 15th of January 2022. So we have about 10 months remaining on this phase of all works. We're currently, the contractor is behind progress, but we're currently pushing them to, complete their task on time, because obviously that's critical in every project. And right now we're seeing some improvement, but there's still to be made more improvement.
Mm-hmm. So next we go to Montreal?
Yes, we'll head to Montreal after this site, and that's more in the heart of St. Vincent, the breadbasket of St. Vincent as they call it. So we'll go there and see how they're progressing there.
Okay. Thank you.
Right now, we reach up on the hill and we wait in a little while. We start preparing going down the next side. So when we start maybe by next week, so we'll start doing the paving on the next side. The bridge which you'll see just now down there, we do some casting on it. We're just waiting to do the platform just now. But other than that, everything going as we wanted it to.
While we were coming up, we saw the tractor, the guy, he was doing some sort of leveling.
Right. So that is the preparation. Before we do the compaction and then we cast it. But as going down the hill now, we just want to wait. So when we do enough preparation now, we could ram it and then start casting one time.
Yeah, basically I know Caribbean is two seasons, rainy season and dry season. So we just have to cope up with the rainy season, which we started this bridge, we encountered a lot of rain, but we have our access. We prepared this bypass that we were never bothered, even though we have a major flood or anything, that the water will just pass through, that will not bother the construction phase.
Okay. So right now you will redirect to the river. When everything goes back to normal, the river will come through here.
Yeah. By the time we cast the deck slab, then we can open now the river, close that one, and then we can now continue the roadworks to complete the job now, because this one is just an extra 400 meters to the next bridge, and that one will complete the job.
We're continuing on our tour. We are now at Sayers, in the heart of Sayers. So give me your impressions on your first visit.
When I came, because it was you call this a virgin road, because no vehicle was coming through. So we have to cut. This is a virgin road. You know, I saw the challenges, but love construction and know what you're doing. And we have all that we want to do it. You know, we just make it easy. Make it easy.
Give us your impression of the work that's going on here. Actually, what was the road like? You used to traverse this road a lot before?
I used to travel on this road a lot before. It's 20-something years I traveling on this road. This road was a track before this concrete here. Come here. And after a while, when rain come, people, neighbor, they bank slide, come down, damage up everything for them. can't get through, because even though when we start to walk here, and when we come, we had also leave the tractor and the truck up there. Couldn't walk.
What makes this project unique?
Well, this road in particular, this would be a link road between the Richland Park Highway along the Mesopotamian Road and Yambu Provenville link road. So in any event, if there's, let's say, some type of disruption between the flow along those roads, we can have a link between those two roads. In times of disasters, you know, these things may happen, so it's always beneficial to the country to have these sort of link roads.
Yes, my name is Osvaldo. I work for Narco Dewey Consultant. The project already is finished, is open to traffic since 20th of January. The people is using the road to come to the beach, to do picnic. And the main things we get in the project was that the alignment on the road and the profile of the road is very good. If you drive the road, you know, will feel a big change when you drive, so it's very comfortable for drivers.
Currently, the contractor has cast the extension of this bridge. The current bridge supported single lane traffic, but as you know, we had some traffic congestion on mornings before they did that bypass at the airport. So in that light, we decided to try and upgrade this bridge so that it can accommodate two lanes, as we also improve this length of road.
Reporting for Inside Story, I am Keisha Woodley.
Eclair Valley Youth is putting cornfish on the front burner. Inside Story returns after the break.
As a medical doctor, a frontline responder, we have a responsibility to ensure that we are protected using an N95 mask. Safe mask saves lives.
Welcome back. Many Vincentians recognize the look, scent, and taste of well-prepared salted fish. Whether eaten with ground provisions or rice, many Vincentians enjoy this delicacy. Despite a growing fisheries sector here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, most of the salted fish consumed is imported. However, one young entrepreneur is looking to change that. With her cornfish, her name is Simisha Batiste. Bavin Olivier has the story.
Welcome to our program. I am Bavin Olivier. On this edition of Inside Story, I have the pleasure to introduce you to Simisha Batiste, an enterprising young lady from Clare Valley. She is the face behind SCB's Cornfish and is one of the candidates on this year's BOSVG calendar. Simisha, thank you for allowing us to interview you.
You're welcome.
All right, tell us a bit about who you are. Who is Simisha Batiste?
I am Simisha Batiste. I was born and raised in the fishing village of Clare Valley. I attended the Clare Valley Primary School, then I attended Bishop's College, Kingston, where I developed a love for agriculture, and then I pursued my studies at the SVGCC Technical College, where I studied agriculture and entrepreneurship.
Okay, in terms of the culinary arts, did you pick up that love for this area from college or from secondary school?
Well, from college. I started my product at college.
Okay. What would have inspired you to, you know, start this this product?
Well, it basically was supposed to be a project that I was supposed to do at the end of my entrepreneurship course. And as my family is engaged in fishing, I decided to do something along the fishing industry.
Okay. Is cornfish your favorite meal?
Yes, it is.
So your family, are they involved in your business?
Well, my parents, both mom and dad, they are. My dad is actually who financed me in terms of the business. And my mom is who helped me gather the fish because she works at the fish market.
As you said, you did agriculture at secondary school and at college, and of course your business also involves fish. Do you see, you know, SCB's cornfish becoming a viable opportunity for persons both in the fishing sector and in agriculture?
Yes, I do.
Have you been able to establish any relationships with any fisher folk so far?
Well, yeah, because I actually have families who do fishing, who own their own boats and stuff like that.
Okay, do you ever get the opportunity to go out and fish?
Only on wharf.
So you never get to go onto the boat itself to see where your corn fish come from?
No.
Okay, in terms of SCB's cornfish, what's your vision for it? Where do you see it in the next 10, 15 years?
Well, I see my business as a big business at the end of the day. I want to be a business that is international.
And of course, you're a young person. What advice would you have to give to other young people who might want to start their own business?
Well, for the young people, I want to say that don't look at agriculture as just something that you be in the dirt, something dirty. Look at it as something big, something that you can create your own opportunities instead of waiting on people to give you jobs.
All right, and do you think you'll be able to get some partnerships with, let's say, some restaurants and cookshops?
Maybe I will.
So what variety of fish do you use for this process?
Well, I normally use different variety, but today this is salmon. Okay. We're using salmon.
Anything special about the salmon?
Not really.
Not really? So it doesn't have extra fat, extra cholesterol, nothing like that?
Well, mainly we use the white meat. So that's why. The white meat fish.
Okay. So when you're preparing the fish, what's the first thing you do?
Clean it. Slice it up, make sure it have the parts so that the salt can go in.
Okay, and then after that, what do you do?
We salt it.
Okay, you could show us how you salt it.
You open the cuts.
The purpose is to basically cover the fish in salt.
Yes.
I know some persons of the younger generation might not know why you salt the fish. You could tell them why you would, you know, put salt on it.
Preservation.
Normally for a fish this size, you use the entire bag of that or more.
Yeah. And then you leave it a day. Okay. You leave it overnight. Normally when you wake in the morning, you don't see all the salt. They melt. And then you just put it in the sun to dry 2 to 3 days. Depends on the fish, how thick the meat.
You don't get problems with insects and so on going to it?
Well, normally I use a net where flies and things can't bomb on it.
Okay. Right, and even though you use a net, there's no like rodents that would try to run around and try to get to it. Alright, now after the fish is dried, you could take us through the process of packaging.
So after it is dry, well, I normally weigh them in a pong or 2 pongs, right? I seal them in these bags or sealer bags.
Any particular reason why you would use that particular bag? Is it more durable than anything of less?
Well, the sealer bags is better, but this is what they have here.
Okay.
And then normally we want all the eight to be out. And then here we go. Package canned fish.
Ooh, let me see. Nice and sealed. Any idea how long the fish can stay in a bag right now?
Well, canned fish normally don't spoil. Don't spoil.
Yeah.
So you can keep it as long as you want.
Nice. Alright. Now we're going to the cooking part. So in terms of preparing the canned fish, do you prepare it the same as salt fish?
Yes, you do. Cut up your onion, your sweet pepper, your tomato, everything, and then it's straight down.
Alright, what's your favorite ingredient to put in there?
Tomato.
Tomato because it gets a nice color? Now we'll take the opportunity to sample your prized corn fish.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Simisha, for allowing us to interview you today.
And you're welcome.
All right, and I wish you all the success in your business. And this has been another edition of Inside Story, reporting for the API. I am Bavin Oliver.
We bring you part two of the Quadril feature. This story coming up next.
The hospitality industry has been suffering for the past year and a half. Now we have a chance to do something. Let's get vaccinated. Let's keep our workers employed. Let's get the hospitality rolling once again. Let's get St. Vincent back to some normalcy. Get vaccinated.
The spread of the virus in our place and do not procrastinate. But rather let us vaccinate.
Get vaccinated today.
Welcome back to Inside Story. In this segment, we continue our exposition on the national dance of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the Quadril. Juanita Phillips, officer assigned to dance in the Department of Culture, takes us through the moves and intricacies of this timeless expression of our national heritage.
The national dance of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the Quadril dance. Presented to you by the Department of Culture. Hear the sweet sound of the steel, listen to the heartbeat of the boom drum. Look at the rhythmic flow of the dancers. The quadrille dance, the national dance of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Know your history.
So what you're viewing, what I'm going to be explaining to you is the basics of the quadrille dance. There are certain movements that are required when doing this national dance of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Now, because it's a stylized dance, persons could put their own choreography, but these are the basic things that must be considered when doing so. So we start male, female facing each other. The first step is the curtsy male bow. So ladies, open your skirts, keep your eyes on your partner. The male bows with their hand extending to welcome her. So we'll do this together. This is done together when you're doing the actual choreography. So you've seen what the ladies do when curtsying and what the men do when bowing. So we're going to do it together. And this is done before and after every figure. Now, the next important thing you have to consider, there after the roll to introduce the figure, there are four beats. It goes. Okay, so the drummers would go one, two, we step in on three. The male extends their hand flat, female place her hand in the male's. And then we go, now keep in mind that this is a quadrille, so it means four. So we do four counts of everything. Women are always slightly lean forward, and the men slight lean back. So that's the position usually for the majority of figures when doing the choreography. So we go, this is us turning. Go one, two, three. On the fourth count, we prize. And there we go again. This is the first figure. One, two, three, four. So another basic of the quadrille is keeping your eyes on your partner. And we'll just demonstrate in the first figure. It goes bum, 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 bum. Bum, 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 bum. That kind of thing. So it's a look away and towards your partner.
First figure, figure one.
So we'll show you the same thing on a quicker pace. Five, six, seven, go. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. Gets you right back in the position you first started. Well, we didn't start at this position, but whichever position you start on, you are supposed to end in that position at the end of the figure. For the beginning of the figure, the positions remain. Male on this end, females on whichever end. It would depend on the stage you're using, the space you're using.
Second figure, figure two.
Okay, so another significant part of the quadrille is when you're traveling to a partner. And this, of course, is done in the square because the lady starts from her partner. She does the entire square and ends back at her partner. So when you're doing the traveling, your skirt, of course, just to add some flair and dynamics, you have the use of your skirt, and the females are slightly hunched over to show, to give more movement in the hip area and the waistline. And the men, of course, are receiving the ladies as they come. On turning, remember it's four counts for everything because it's a quadrille. That's a very good thing to remember, a very good point to remember. So we'll take it around, you go, you travel to your partner, then you go around one, two, three, four. Now I'm going to leave him to travel to another partner while he's receiving the other person coming on his left. One, two, three, four.
Figure three.
For figure four, what is pretty significant when viewing the various groups who do the quadrille is the interchanging of the men and the women, making a star pattern, moving inward and outward. It is important for the men to always start with on their heel, as shown here, with their arms swinging left and right, and turn, go, one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Heel. One, two, three. Stay. Yes? For the females, when they're interchanging, same thing. They have the use of the skirts. Their skirts go in and out. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four.
Fourth figure. Figure four.
The fifth figure. Fifth figure. Now, for this, it goes Miss Amy, Amy coming down with a bunch of roses coming down. Bap. Very sharp. And as soon as you do this, you look at your partner. Now, the females are going to change positions this way. They're going to lay back. So their pelvic facing forward, their back slightly bent, looking to their partners. And then we go looking in. One, two, three, four. Look, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Look, two, three, four. Now, it is important that you keep the movement in your waistline. So, Stanley, if you'll demonstrate the male part, please.
Hand on the lower of the back.
So if you see, it's important that you keep this waistline moving.
Fifth figure, figure five.
One of the important factors is that you keep your eyes on your partner, because you have this kind of chemistry going on. It's how you enjoy your partner. Do you get to feed off the energy of your partner? Your partner allows you to be free, engaging in the movements, and just ready to party.
The cross is the way to go. Learn how to make palm crosses on Community Beat. More when Inside Story returns.
Mastery score and cross lines. Combat climate change. We're fighting global warming. You can participate. Restoring our beaches. Preserving our reefs. Increasing tourism. More jobs within reach. The South Coast Marine and Coastal Rehabilitation Adaptation Project. Located south of the island, extending to over five bays, White Sands, Kanash, Kaliakwa, Villa, and Indian Bay. Let's improve aquatic life. A message from the National Parks, Rivers, and Beaches Authority and partners.
The cross is one of the most prolific symbols in Christianity, and can be found in churches, works of art, construction, fashion, jewelry, and the list goes on. The cross is also an important feature in Palm Sunday celebrations. Mrs. Frailing Samuel, a member of the Anglican Church, takes us through the process of making palm crosses on the Community Beat.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen from the dead. And our price at Calvary has been won and paid by Him. That's the best way I can put it. In lowly pomp, ride on to die. And the pointers can be used, you know, to make baskets.
How do you use them in the service?
We bless them with holy water. And then when they're finished blessing now, you distribute them to the congregation.
People pin them on?
Yeah, you can pin them on, and you take them home to other shut-ins and relatives who are unable to come to church. Also, these palms can be put up or must be, you know, put away until Ash Wednesday. You burn them to get the cross on your forehead.
So this is a tradition in Anglican Church?
Anglican, Catholic, Methodist, Salvation Army.
So this is for Palm Sunday?
Palm Sunday. And Palm Sunday, the colors are red, which signifies the triumphant entry into Jerusalem by Jesus on his donkey, or on a donkey. We get them and we have a procession from where the palms are distributed. We have a procession right up to the church.
Any music?
It all depends. Sometimes you'll have accompaniment, but most of the time you just sing like that. When you get to church, the music will be playing. It depends on what hymn or whichever hymn you're singing, because you have two hymns, Ride On, Ride On, and you have Palms of Glory, Raiment Bright. Depends on whichever hymns you're singing, the musical accompaniment will play to that for the congregation.
Could you sing a little of one of them, please?
Ride on in majesty. Right? In lowly pomp, ride on to die. I can't remember the rest of the words.
Sounds like a nice song. Ride on.
Yeah. La da 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 da. Da 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 da. And the other one is Palms of Glory, Raiment Bright. Da 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 da. Would you be able to make one?
I will try. That seems like it looks simple, but
yeah.
Let me watch you again.
1-4, 1-4, 2-4, 1-4, 2-4. And you turn it right there.
Right.
And then across, then this way. Then you cross it in the back.
Cross it in the back.
And you push it through the first fold. Push it through the first fold.
This one.
Yeah, bring it over.
Bring it over.
Uh-huh. And you
bring it over away. May push it to the fourth hole. Bring it over away.
Bring it over again. Behind.
Again.
And push it over the four into the fourth hole. And pull it again. Just to make sure that it's firm and that it would not get away. Give it another fold again. And then you do that. Push it back to turn it around now.
So the face on me?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you push it back to the same hole, the first hole. No, I don't want to see. Go up.
No.
Yeah, you're going right. No, go back up.
Go back.
Up. Right, leave it there. And you have your cross.
Oh, that's it. Oh. It's kind of slack.
Yeah. Good for the first try.
Yeah.
Try again. Look at me. Ride on in majesty. In lowly pomp, ride on to die. Ride on in majesty. In lowly pomp, ride on to die. Ride on in majesty. In lowly pomp.
Why is Easter special to you?
Easter reminds us of the resurrection and the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And he died on the cross to save us as sinners from sin. And as the scripture readings say, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We all are sinners, and He paid the price at Calvary for our sins today.
So Easter is a joyful time.
Yes. Yeah. And it signifies that He is risen. He says risen. Yeah. And they sing this hymn most of the time: up from the grave He arose, with the mighty triumph from the grave. He arose from victor, from the dark domain. You know? That's him. They sing at Easter time. And He lives forever with His saints to reign. He arose, He arose. Hallelujah. Christ arose. And you pull it, but be careful how you pull it, because you can burst it. And this is it.
Mm-hmm. Yours them look really nice.
Hmm?
Yours them look really nice. Mm-hmm. Mine them need help. Ooh. Ah.
Once you
wait,
get in, yeah.
I'm missing something.
Okay, then you throw that through there. And
oh, uh-huh, uh-huh. Yeah, this one is much. This one is much better.
Yeah. When we return, Inside Minute takes you back to the roots of Easter.
Tourism has many benefits to St. Vincent and the Grenadines. It creates growth and a boost in economic activities, infrastructure development, job creation, entrepreneurship, and is a source of foreign exchange earnings. Supermarkets and vendors, bars, restaurants, taxis, tour guides, hotels, service providers, and many more all benefit directly from income gained through the tourism industry. Taxes collected from visitors to our country help St. Vincent's economy and its growth. Tourism is everyone's business. Live it, love it, embrace it.
Tourism is everyone's business. Yeah. Live it, love it, embrace it.
Easter. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. The Gospel of Mark 16:6. Here lies the crux of the Christian faith and the Easter tradition that celebrates the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. This from the Gospel of St. Luke. According to History.com, the New Testament of the Bible records Jesus' resurrection 3 days after He was crucified by the Romans around 30 AD. The holiday concludes the Passion of Christ, a series of events and holidays that begins with Lent, a 40-day period of fasting, prayer, and sacrifice, and ends with Holy Week, which includes Holy Thursday, the celebration of Jesus' Last Supper with His 12 apostles, also known as Maundy Thursday, Good Friday on which Jesus' crucifixion is observed, and Easter Sunday.
Keep me near the cross, near the cross. May I never stray so far.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
My name is Ruth Stevens, and I'm the owner of Hotel Alexandrina. Currently, most of the hotels are empty. The cruise ship berth is vacant. The airport almost shut down. And we, as Vincentians, cannot get back to the new normal until most of the Vincentians take the vaccination. We want to improve our economy, and the only way we can do that is to get Vincentians to take the vaccine. I have taken it, and I'm fine.
And do not procrastinate, but rather let us vaccinate. Hi.
Scripture says in John 16:33, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Indeed, we are living in troubling times, from the COVID-19 pandemic, dengue, and the threat of Lassifer eruption. In these troubling times, Reverend Adolph Davis brings a message of hope and comfort to all Vincentians as we celebrate Easter 2021.
Christian Council Easter message to St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the citizens of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. Hymn by Robert Lowry. This is perhaps one of the more catchy and loved hymns and phrases for Resurrection Sunday. This celebratory, triumphant spirit in this hymn seems to reflect the approach used in the Gospels, particularly John, in John with the words, "Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark." John 20 verse 1. A phrase that has been considered variously over the years, perhaps because it encapsulates the very essence of the resurrection: victory over sin, darkness, and evil. One of the most important messages of the resurrection is the triumph of good over evil. The struggle with evil, suffering, and pain, not the same things, has been one of the perennial battles for human beings in the mind, spirit, and body. Our experiences of evil, suffering, and pain have not only affected us physically and existentially, but also caused great emotional stress and psychological, theological, and intellectual wrestlings. It is the kind of struggle that caused Mary and Martha to greet Jesus with the words, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died," in John chapter 11. Or the psalmist who cried out, "Why does the wicked exalt? Why does the wicked prosper?" The kind of struggle that gave rise to the story of the book of Job. This has continued to be a real struggle for many. Why do we suffer so greatly? Why the losses and the pains? Why the disappointments and betrayals? Why does it seem that those who do evil and wrong seem to benefit more than those who try to do right? This struggle is compounded by the biblical view of God as one who is all-powerful and all-loving, as many cannot fathom. If I am loved, then why am I going through this? In fact, if I am loved by a God who has the power to change things, then why are things the way they are? It is unfortunate, but many have lost hope in life, become cynical and pessimistic, and believe the best antidote for disappointment is not to expect much in the first place. Some have resented the idea of God or a loving God, while others have refused to pray or believe in prayer, since the last great need I prayed for never came through. The resurrection is the most profound response to the question of evil and its exceptional resource for hope and resilience. In the resurrection, we discover a God whose very Son suffers the worst of human evil. He doesn't avoid it or evade it, but he faces this problem of evil head on. Here is one who was betrayed, insulted, lied on, abandoned, and the list goes on. Only for doing good. He too prayed, let this cup pass from me, Matthew 26:39. Only for that prayer not to be answered, we discovered through this amazing story that the solution to the problem of evil, suffering, and pain in our world is not to escape it, avoid it, or evade it, but to overcome it by faith in God through Jesus Christ. We learn how God uses suffering redemptively. This is important for us as we continue to see great suffering and incomprehensible evils in our world. Some brought on by the pandemic, others accentuated by the pandemic, while others were just a continuation of our pre-pandemic reality. We see more and more political divisiveness and the dishonesties that come with it. We see how people are used and manipulated. We hear of and experience stories of abuse and violence. We see the examples in our world of greed and selfishness, that even in a pandemic economy, we will learn that in some countries, some people demand increases and bonuses, or we see how unwilling some are to make sacrifices or experience inconvenience for the well-being of others or all. Me, my. The struggles of and sufferings people have been trying to navigate with the loss of income or no income at all are part of the struggles that we have seen in our world. People who previously thought they had it together having suicide ideation. The resurrection is an invaluable message in the midst of the brokenness, sufferings, and evils of our world. What message does the resurrection bring to our political leaders, government, or opposition? What message does it bring to the teachers, the Ministry of Education as a whole, and the students? What message does the resurrection bring to the Ministry of Health and other ministries, public officials, and or to business owners? What message does the resurrection bring to the street vendor or the homeless beggar, to the preacher or the church member? The resurrection reminds that good triumphs over evil, that the success of evil is short-lived. 3 days. Evil, suffering, and pain are temporary. The resurrection infuses us with an optimism that even when the now seems overwhelming, faithfulness to God brings unspeakable joy and outstanding victory. It challenges us to embrace a humility that says, while we cannot understand the complexities of life, nor grasp the fullness of God's wisdom, what God has implanted as immutable in His created world is that good will triumph over evil. The resurrection story humbles us to a realization that while we do not fully comprehend the sufferings and crucifixion of Christ Jesus, while we do not fully understand why God did not answer His prayer, while we don't always understand why we are going through the pains and problems, why God didn't answer the prayer the way we had hoped He would, the immutable truth is good triumphs over evil, particularly and especially when we trust in God. It cautions us, the resurrection that is, from giving up. From if you can't beat them, join them. It cautions us from being too short-sighted and overwhelmed by the current thrivings of the wicked and evil. It reminds us never to turn to evil to overcome evil. The resurrection encourages us to wait. Wait. Even if our 3 days seem like forever. Wait. We are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. The resurrection, therefore, is an antidote for fear. This is critical in a world where so many people, so many things and people encourage fear. Whether we are willing to so label it as fear or not, we are afraid of the foods we eat. We are afraid of COVID-19. We are afraid of the vaccines. We are afraid of an explosive eruption. We are afraid of people in power. We are afraid of our employees. We are afraid of supervisors. We are afraid of flying. We are afraid of van drivers. So much of our lives are gripped by fear, often peddled by conspiracy theories, social media musings, and ignorance, irresponsible leaders and influencers. We are afraid of losing our jobs, not being able to support our families. We're afraid of getting sick. We're afraid of being robbed, raped, shot. We're afraid of failure. We're afraid of success. We're afraid of what our neighbor will do to us or the thing they left in our yard. We're afraid of so much and many that we need to be careful we're not afraid of our own shadows. The resurrection is a message of triumph that infuses us with hope, not fear. It empowers us to live and to live rightly and meaningfully. It certainly can invigorate us in knowing that after 3 days, in and through Jesus Christ, we shall overcome. Perhaps that's why the hymn writer says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. And our brother Laurie says, up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with the saints to raise. He arose. That's the victory song. And that is for all of us. He arose. Hallelujah. Christ arose. God bless you.
You have been watching Inside Story. If you know of persons who are doing positive things in your community, let us know who and where they are. Please send the relevant information to apisvg2014@gmail.com. The next community beat might just be coming from your community or one near you. The API wishes to extend thanks to the Anglican Church for use of their premises. Until next time, here's wishing everyone a reflective, spirit-filled, and blessed Easter holiday. Good evening. I am Moeth Games.